Hello and welcome to the very first episode of Pause, where we plan to bring you the latest news and opinion from the world of cinema. Alongside me this week, giving their opinions, Ross Hunt and Niall Davies. My name is Jamie Mepham and I'm your host for this week, and coming up in today's show, we'll be discussing the fallout from Cannes Film Festival, which wrapped up this past Sunday, taking a closer look at Nicholas Winding Refn's Only God Forgives, starring Ryan Gosling. We'll be looking at two romantic comedies scheduled for release later this year, and discussing the genre's overall appeal to the male demographic. And finally, in light of The Hangover Part 3 hitting our cinema screens this week, we'll be discussing our favourite buddy movies and why they usually end up a success at the box office. Okay, let's look at our first topic, Cannes Film Festival. It wrapped up on Sunday. List of the winners, La Vie d'Adèle, Chapter 1 and 2, French film, which translates,
Blue is the Warmest Colour.
Nicely done. Yeah, a lot of, in terms of all the winners...
Blue Angel, it will be known as in Blue America. Angel.
Will it? Oh, there we go.
Fun fact
for you. Yeah, so yeah, a lot of winners coming out that obviously not necessarily mainstream that we would be aware of in the UK or in the US, but having read a few reviews, all the stuff that's come out of the festival, Niall, your opinions on what you're excited to see or kind of stuff that's come up from it.
Well, the films I'm excited to see, Blood Ties and Borgman, and of course Only God Forgives, tend to be the films that flopped. So I don't know how good my opinion is going to be on this, but Blood Ties looks great. It's a crime set in the 70s, and it's got Clive Owen, Zoe Saldana, Mila Kunis, Billy Crudup, Marion Cotillard.
Pisses me off to have to do these shitty jobs. Pisses me off to see you at a fucking desk.
This is a song about a bad girl.
And you want to change?
Something that happened to me.
Don't give me that shit, right? You can't change. You're trash to the core.
Everybody was telling me how.
I can remember the first time that he was in prison. I was so pissed because fucking idolized that guy. He was my hero.
Billy Crudup and Clive Owen just come out. Clive Owen's come out of prison. They're both on the opposite sides of the law. And it's this clash that these siblings have. And, it looks good. It looks like a good fan 70s kind of film, like embracing the era and everything. And then you got Borgman, which is a Dutch film. And it's about a woodsman kind of invading these rich folks' life. And, it's quite surreal, it seems. It looks really, really interesting. But again, both flopped.
Lost anything that you...
Well, going back to Blue is the Warmest Colour, it's very sort of... Films about sexuality at the moment are very sort of.
Yeah, I believe the way they described it is a graphic lesbian drama. So, yeah.
We're seeing it. No, I mean, there's a lot. There's obviously in the past Brokeback Mountain, got Acclaim, and the new Michael Douglas film Behind the Candelabra. So, there's a lot of focus on that because it's such a powerful and controversial topic. So, I think that's why it's getting a lot of recognition in the industry right now.
And in France, of course, you've got all the gay marriage going on, the rights for gay marriage, and maybe that film struck a chord, in the French conscious at the moment. So perhaps that's why they felt it.
That's a fair point. I'll probably say the one that we're probably most familiar with in terms of cast and obviously directors, the Coen brothers. They got the runner-up prize, Inside Llewyn and Davis. That's the name of their film, which is basically the Greenwich Village folk scene, which isn't particularly something I would be. Definitely interested in, but the cast has got Justin Timberlake, Carey Mulligan, John Goodman, a lot of big stars that we would be familiar with, and it's had some rave reviews, so obviously anyone's going to end up runner-up. Obviously it's a good film, so that's out at the end of the year, so go see that if you can, or at least...
Of course, we're the Coen Brothers fans here.
There we go. So that's big. So if we move on now to what's a bit more in-depth, Only God Forgives.
Your brother would have found you a kidder. Brought me his head on a fucking
want to fight.
Looks really good, but the reviews haven't necessarily been completely great. So, from what we've read, what would you say your opinion of it is now?
I'm still definitely excited to see it. I mean, it got 5 stars by The Guardian. You know, from what I read from the review, it sounds pretty good. But obviously, conversely, I've heard other reviews, people walking out of the auditorium.
Yeah, it was very, apparently cheers and boos were, which is, you know.
But for me, I mean, you know, I'm not going to take either side of the fence until I see the film. And so I'm still anticipating the film a lot. I think it's going to be a good film.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's, I think a lot of people going in there expecting another Drive film because that's the sort of recognition it's got, but like it's very, what I've heard, it's very nasty and violent, so a lot of people aren't expecting that. So that could be a reason why, you know, a lot of people sort of have issues with it. But I mean, I think it's great. Like, yeah, Ryan Gosling, and it works.
What they've said
is
it's similar in tone to Drive, and again, Drive at times is very violent.
The subtlety of it, isn't it?
Yeah. I think perhaps, you know, yeah, it would just, maybe people weren't necessarily expecting some, because some of the stuff I've read, it is very graphic.
Mm.
So perhaps people not necessarily weren't expecting that, so maybe that's where
the
big lashings of boos and, you know, during the press screenings, maybe that's where that's coming from. Mm. But I'm still excited to see it. It still looks really, really good.
Definitely. I will watch it.
So yeah, it's out here August, August 2nd, I believe, over here in the UK. So yeah, check that out when it comes out, because we've not got long to wait.
There's only a few things I really care about in life. My body, my pad, my ride, my family, my church, my boys, my girls, and my porn. My body, my pad, my ride, my family, my church, my boys, my girls, my porn. Body, pad, ride, family, church, boys, girls.
My dear son, this is going to sound strange, but there's this secret that the men in this family can travel in time. You have to be very careful when you use it. The butterfly effect thing, that's a real recipe for disaster.
It's so good to see you.
We've never met before.
Oh no.
Okay, so, moving on. Two trailers, two rom-coms that we looked at just before we started recording. Don John, written, directed and starring Joseph Gordon-Levitt. And then About Time, starring Domhnall Gleeson and veteran of the rom-com, Rachel McAdams. Now, which one of these two would you say, as a man, you are more looking forward to seeing? Be honest. No.
Don John. Off the blocks.
Don John.
No way.
Yeah, no, it looks better to me, you know.
In what way? Because they're both romantic comedies, they're both, you know.
Yeah, but, I mean, Don John appeals more to me, because it looks slicker, it looks happier, you know. It doesn't look like they're going to struggle over some sort of plot device that's just been tacked on, perhaps. It might have been written with in mind, but whatever. And, you know, the little twist with the pornography.
Mm.
I'd like to see how that plays
interesting,
out.
Interesting, yeah. For a comedy as well, that's
yeah.
Really fascinating.
Yeah, for me, Don John as well, it just feels, like I say, a lot more happier. I think Americans do rom-coms better. Like, the whole feel of the film, the location, it just feels like a more positive and happy vibe.
Yeah, so About Time, it's, you know, quintessentially a British rom-com. It's Richard Curtis, obviously written, you know, Four Weddings and a Funeral, Bridget Jones's Diary, Love Actually, you know, all commercially, critically good films, good rom-coms, but not necessarily, I would doubt there are many males' favourite rom-com or favourite film. And why is that? And I think About Time's probably going to be put in that bracket as well. What is it about the film that you don't think necessarily appeals to you as a man? What would you say, Ross?
I feel like when you look at Don John, Joseph Gordon-Levitt in that film, he seems like quite a likeable, quirky guy who a lot of blokes can relate to, you know, in the way they live their lives. Whereas when you look at
I don't know what I do.
Yeah, you know what I mean. But I mean, and then in terms of About Time, it's sort of very. He just seems quite a boring guy who's sort of stuck almost. And I don't think a lot of men will go and see that sort of romantic sort of vibe that he's giving off.
It's my thing is very the whole lovey-dovey kind of thing, that when it's kind of rammed down your throat from the beginning of a film, that's when I kind of go, that kind of puts me off, when you see it in the trailer.
It's unnatural.
Yeah, yeah. I want something that's going to be like, you know, the raw emotions of the characters come out, and then therefore a romantic gesture from either part comes out, something you can try and relate to a bit more than purely setting out, you know, because some go over the space of months, even years sometimes, but purely your whole focus for 3 or 4 months is how romantic I'm going to be and how I'm going to swoon this girl or boy kind of thing, and that just doesn't feel natural. So for me personally, take nothing away from everyone who enjoys that sort of thing, for me it's not.
You know, Richard Curtis seems to have a habit or tendency to make his characters so upper class, like just makes it so unrelatable for the average guy who's probably going to go to the cinema. You know, no one's going to relate to Hugh Grant or Bill Nighy.
Yeah.
Okay, so if we're looking back on the past few years or so, some examples of some rom-coms that would probably appeal to the female demographic as much as the male, and you know, whether it's critically or commercially, they are a success that you wouldn't want to say, hey, watch this. You go, Niall, what would you say?
Well, 40-year-old Virgin, I mean, that's a rom-com. It's good hugely successful. It's a good film. It's a good film. Crazy Stupid Love. You know, Silver Linings Playbook.
Yeah.
I mean, with British films, these British rom-coms, Four Winds and Fury and Living, you know they're going to get together at the end. I know with About Time they're going to get together at the end.
Yeah.
Even with all this crazy time travel going on, they shouldn't, because of paradoxes and whatnot.
Yeah.
No, they're going to get together at the end, even if she turns out to be his mum. it's just one of those things. Like, but with Silver Linings, watching that, not once did I, you know, expect they were going to get together at the end. And, you know, that's the difference, I think.
Yeah. So last word then. Would you say at the moment they're splitting into more lovey-dovey rom-coms and the ones that perhaps we would be more keen to going and seeing? Would you say that's kind of the path we're going down now? Is it always going to be a little bit taboo for, you know, the majority of males to go and see a rom-com?
I think that, you know, there'll always be, couples are always going to go watch these sort of films because that's their target market. But I just feel like like I said earlier, Americans seem to do it better. Like with a big example for me would be like Friends with Benefits.
Yeah,
they take quite a controversial and sort of topic that I spoke about a lot, and then they broadcast it out, so it's out in the open. I think a lot of couples and even, you know, guys and girls who are going by themselves can just watch it and just have a bit of fun with it and not look at it so seriously. And I think that's what British rom-coms don't do. They kind of really look at it on an emotional point of view. So it's sort of like a really serious, and some people don't like watching that intensity, let's say, on the first date. So I think that's the...
No, that's a good point. Well, yeah, About Time and John both out later this year, so check them out. Okay, and bringing us to the end of the show, the third topic and final topic, we got The Hangover Part 3 in cinemas at the moment, and it's now become The Hangover franchise, the most successful comedy franchise of all time. Yeah, I was big fans of the first one, not necessarily the second, but big fan of the first one. So, in terms of the buddy movie as a whole, why do we think it's become such a mainstay of cinema, and it doesn't seem to kind of... There's always a kind of buddy movie out there, and it always seems to do, on the whole, pretty well, you know, pretty damn well at the box office. So, what would we say is the key to that success? No.
Well, yeah, kind of like, the rom-com and the love story is about the chemistry between the two characters. And, you know, if you get a good pairing that work well together, then, you know, that's just gold, isn't it, really? And, you know, all the popular ones, there's always good pairings of actors. Robert Downey Jr., Val Kilmer. Robert Downey Jr. is that Galifianakis?
Galifianakis.
Gareth Benakis, whatever.
Robert Downey Jr., Jude Law.
Yeah, Robert Downey Jr., Jude Law. You know,
Robert Downey Jr.
and Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah. So.
Well, that's, I mean, in terms of the buddy movie anyway, I suppose you can say, and it's essentially you can say Star Trek is, in a way, is a buddy film, but primarily in the relationship itself always has some element of comedy to it, doesn't it? So I suppose that's why The Hangover has become as successful as it has.
Yeah. I think a lot of people go and see it because they know what they're going to get from it. They know that they're going to get guys acting absolutely so foolish, and you know, you get set characters, like you get a guy who's very work orientated and then gets taken out of his comfort zone and does bizarre acts, and then you've got Zach Galifianakis, who is that
the oddball.
Stupid oddball. Yeah, so you know what you're going to get, and you know you're going to get laughs, and you know you're going to get pure carnage, really.
Yeah, no, it's good. Yeah. So, if we were saying our favourite ones that we would like to put out there to the people, and if they haven't seen them, they must, what would we say? Boss, do you want to start?
For me, it's got to be, it's a bit old, but it's got to be Dumb and Dumber, Jim Carrey and Jeff Daniels. Oh, it's
very good.
It's just it's about two guys, the dumbest guys you'll know, who somehow stumble on a fortune, and it's just a crazy course of events. You'll love it. Please check it out. It's amazing.
Thank you. Thank you, Ross. No?
For me, it's Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Yeah.
I think the pairing of Robert Downey Jr. and Val Kilmer is genius. It's got some fantastic scenes. Basically, Robert Downey Jr. is a criminal who stumbles into an audition whilst fleeing a crime, gets a role. Val Kilmer plays the detective who he's got to learn from. They end up having a little detective case to solve.
It's very good.
Some great scenes involving Russian roulette and torture with electrodes on testicles.
Mm.
So, spoiler alert.
So what's not to like? Seriously. I've got a few things I'd like to mention. Wayne's World.
Ah,
big fan of Wayne's World. Sequel, not necessarily as good, but still a bit fun. But yeah, it was just a little skit on Saturday Night Live, and it was so good that they made a film out of it. So yeah, that's a good one. And noticeable mention for recently, 21 Jump Street, I thought was pretty good. I wasn't expecting, because I wasn't at the time a massive fan of Channing Tatum. But in
very
that,
good,
he's very, very good. And what was it, Side Effects, we saw recently?
Yeah.
He's really good in that as well. But in 21 Jump Street, obviously Jonah Hill, that kind of buddy, obviously super bad, that kind of thing. He's obviously very good in it. But I wasn't expecting it to be as funny as it was. So that's, you know, a really good recent buddy film.
Another more recent one, which I really enjoyed, was Pineapple Express, I think.
Yeah.
That's really good.
Yeah.
Really,
no,
really
good.
Good.
The car chase in that one. That's
absolutely good. Looking forward to This Is The End.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
another film I'm looking forward to, obviously it's, I suppose, buddy movie again, but obviously it centres around four characters rather than, you know, the typical two or three. Anchorman.
The ultimate buddy movie.
I was a really big fan of the first one at the time. It was good in terms of, you know, the success it got, but it wasn't huge. But since then, it's got such a cult following, and everybody, and probably public demand, I suppose, is what's got another one made. So that's coming out at the end of the year. So what are we? There's a couple of teaser trailers that have been shown, and it's pretty much just, you know, the lineup. You know, pretty simple, kind of saying a few funny comments. Do we think it's going to live up to... Because I'm a huge fan of the first one, so do we think it's going to live up to that or not? Does it matter? Are we still all going to go and see it anyway?
Jesus. MacArthur. Jay-Z. The great ones always return. And when they do, one thing's for sure. Their hair will be perfect.
We haven't seen you in a while, America. You haven't changed a bit.
Well, I've got liquor. For me, like, I really like how the trailers have shown, like, absolutely nothing at all. I think that shows, like, confidence in the film.
Yeah.
I'm expecting it to be good. I hope it'll be
There's
good.
A lot of people in it, from what I've heard, the amount of people, whether it's, you know...
I mean, John C. Reilly was supposed to be in the original, but
Christian Wiig's going to be in this one. Yeah. There's a lot of people, and in terms of, you know, people like Kanye West, Drake, just singers and rappers and celebrities are popping up left, right, and centre. And apparently, another great big gang fight scene with a lot of people in it. Yeah.
Harrison Ford.
Vince Ford. Oh, yeah, Harrison Ford's going to be in it. I think he's going to have a relatively okay part in it.
That's the thing, though. I hope it's not just going to be doing things that happened in Anchorman 1 bigger.
Yeah. So that's the thing, that's the danger, but I think you're gonna laugh, just whether it's gonna be as big as, you know, we all hope it will be, but we're not sure.
Hey! Fat face! You! You stick classy.
Okay, so that brings us nearly to the end of the show, but before we go, I'd like to have a little bit of fun with you guys. And I'd like to do a little segment I'm calling Zero Dark 30. Okay, so, Zero Dark 30 seconds is the name of the segment. And it's pretty simple, guys. Basically, I want you to pitch the plot of a movie to me. And whoever pitches the best plot wins. And what they win is this. One of a kind, limited edition.
Yeah.
Gilbert, Mini.
Top prize.
You can have this for a week.
I want that ball.
For 1 week, you can have that. So, yeah, what we're going to do is I'm going to give you an actor or an actress, I'm going to give you a genre, and I'm going to give you a subject matter. And that's what you've got to come up with, a plot with those three elements. Now, you can add to that, but you have to incorporate all three, or you will be disqualified. Okay, so I'm looking at a timer now, and I flipped a coin before we started recording. Totally fair. Niall, you're going to go first, and Ross will follow. So Ross will have the 30 seconds whilst you're doing your pitch. Ross will have that 30 seconds to think some more. So unfortunately, Niall, you will only have these 30 seconds to come up with your pitch.
Your feeling his is going to be better.
So yeah, Ross, pressure's on you, mate. Pressure is on you. Okay, so, no, five seconds, guys. Can we be quiet in the room? Here we go. The actor, or actress, is Will Smith. The genre, romantic comedy. And the subject matter, is magic. You've got 30 seconds. Think of your pitches, guys. Although, Ross, obviously, you will have slightly more time. So be thinking, guys. Pitching a plot. You're pitching a plot to Hollywood. Trying to impress them. This is on the line. This is on the line. So, yeah, it's really, really important. Okay, here we go, Niall. Here we go. 2, 1, and off we go.
Okay, so typically, as these things start, Will Smith is in a rut. He's married to a woman. But he also tampers in magic, and so he's able to astral project through dimensions into his other body, where he's with a girl who is really hot and attractive, who he loved like when he was younger or something.
Who's the woman now?
Mila Kunis. Oh. And then his reality starts to bleed over, and
five seconds.
Characteristics swap, and he's got to, you know, choose one to restore balance.
I like it. Ross, your pitch, go.
Will Smith is a magician on the magician circuit in Las Vegas, and he meets an arch rival magician S, who is Carey Mulligan, and they're rivals, but they can't. There's a romance between them, so they
10 seconds.
They try and they there's a massive story, and then they get together. They're all in love, and Don Cheadle is the villain trying to split them.
And he did it with seconds to spare. I think that, a little gem at the end. I think I'm going to have to give it to Ross Hunt, everyone. Ross Hunt. He wins the limited edition.
Thank you very much.
Gilbert, Mini, welcome to Gold.
Thank you.
You. Good. Nicely done.
Thank you.
That's our show. So, yeah, thanks for watching. And thank Mr. Ross Hunt. Thank Mr. Niall Davies. And myself, Jamie Mepham, for posting this week. So, come back next week. See you later, guys.
Bye.
Gonna find my baby, gonna hold her tight, gonna grab some afternoon delight. My motto's always been, when it's right, why wait until the middle of a cold, dark night? When everything's a little clearer in the light of day, and we know the night is always gonna be there anyway. Thinking of you's working up my appetite. Looking forward to a little afternoon delight. Rubbing sticks and stones together, making sparks ignite. And the thought of loving you is getting so exciting. Sky rockets in flight.
Woo!
Afternoon delight.
Whoop!
You guys have it, I think.
Afternoon delight.